The Cradle Will Rock. I wrote both the words and the music at white heat during 5 weeks in 1936. Its first paid public performance at the Venice Theater in New York City in June 1937 provided one of the most curious and, I am informed, spectacular evenings in the history of the American theater. It isn't often that the opening of a play in New York is the touch-off for a front-page spread in all the next day's papers. The story of the Cradle's opening has taken on a somewhat legendary gloss and blur over the years, and there are many embellished and apocryphal versions of it. I'm going to try to tell it now as I remember it, the things I know to be facts, and the things that others present told me. When I played The Cradle Will Rock for Orson Welles, he was just 21, but already an extravagantly brilliant and magnetic theater man. He fell in love straight off and made me promise that no matter who should produce it, he would do the staging, and I was glad to agree. Many producers then toyed with the notion of putting it on. All of them dropped it. It was considered hot stuff politically, since it dealt with a rising struggle for unionism in America, specifically in the steel industry, at a time when the combine known as Little Steel was all over the newspapers with its union problems. Finally, Wells and John Houseman decided to produce the work at the Maxine Elliott Theater under the auspices of the Federal Theater Project, which they had joined. That organization was government-subsidized during the Depression days, and everyone from the charwoman who swept the theater floor to the most ambitious producer earned the same $28 a week. It is not very fashionable these days to refer admiringly to the Federal Theater Project, and yet it was responsible for a great number of today's writers, stars, directors, and stage designers. We had unlimited time to prepare the production, and we had really quite extraordinary talents in every department at our disposal. The rehearsals moved towards a state of perfection rarely attained in our present-day theater. But as our opening date began to loom, rumors became rife that the Cradle might not be permitted to rock publicly at all. One reason given was the unionism subject matter. Another was my secondary theme of literal prostitution, personified by the Moll, set against the background of prostitution of another kind, the sellout of one's profession, one's talents, one's dignity and integrity at the hands of big business or the powers that be. At any rate, on the chance that we might never really open, Wells and Houseman invited to our final dress rehearsal the most elite New York audience imaginable. That rehearsal was the first and the last time the work has ever been fully performed exactly as I wrote it, and it seemed a success. The next day, we waited with some impatience for the traditional telegram from Washington authorizing us to go ahead with our premiere. It was not forthcoming. Instead, the military appeared. The box office personnel were instructed to turn away ticket buyers, and the sets and costumes were placed out of reach. And now the irrepressible energy and lightning drive of Orson Welles revealed themselves. He called us all, the entire production complement of cast, stage managers, musicians, and stagehands, together in the only theater green room we had. It was actually the ladies' powder room downstairs. I remember an unexplained pink velvet mannequin standing in one corner. Wells said to us, "We have a production ready. We have a fully paid audience outside." It was true. Many people had come early in the afternoon and were standing in front of the theater. They had heard the rumors, and they scented excitement. "And," said Wells, "we will have our premiere, and tonight." But how? And where? The first thing was to find a theater. But in the meantime, there were a dozen other jobs to do. What was the contractual situation of the actors, of the musicians? Could they leave this theater and perform the work elsewhere? A telephone call to Actors' Equity Union produced the information, it turned out later to be false, that the actors could not perform Cradle on any other stage under different auspices without losing their status in the project. Then we were told by the musicians local that moving our orchestra to another theater pit would set us in competition with regular Broadway musicals, and that not only would the men have to be paid Broadway salaries, but we would have to increase the number of musicians instead of reducing it. However, said this informant, if we called ourselves a concert and put our musicians on stage, then we could use as many or as few as we could afford. So there we were in the position of having a production without a theater, actors who could not appear on stage, and musicians who could appear nowhere else, enough to make the stoutest enthusiast admit defeat and give up. But Wells proceeded to solve problems with an ingenuity, a speed, and a daring I can almost not believe as I tell it. To the actors, he said, "You may not appear on stage, but there is nothing to prevent you from buying your way into whatever theater we find. And then, why not get up from your seats as first-class American citizens, speak your piece when your cue comes?" About the music, Wells, consulting Houseman, decided we could afford only one musician, which would be myself, at a piano, on stage. I had indeed played and sung the work so often for prospective producers, we used to call it my Essex House run, and I had done so many rehearsals with our actors that I felt quite confident and nothing loath. At once, we all began to catch fire. The ladies' powder room of the Maxine Elliott Theater became a beehive of activity, an arsenal of planning. Newspaper agencies, reporters, and photographers were summoned with the word that something was up. By this time, it was 6 o'clock in the evening. A large crowd had gathered in front of the house, undaunted by military or box office pronouncements of no show tonight. Wells wanted to keep them there, so he sent out two of our actors to sing songs from the Cradle and entertain them until we could tell them where to go to see the production. And still no theater. It was summertime, and most empty theaters were in mothballs and probably wouldn't contain a piano anyway. Houseman dispatched little Jean Rosenthal, our production manager, then a pint-sized child just out of college, with a $10 bill in her hand. She was to board and commandeer the first available truck on the street and circle with it around the block while we tried to locate a rentable piano. We found one by phone. Yes, the landlady downtown said, we could borrow her piano. So Jeannie was shouted the address, for once out of the theater, you didn't get back in, with instructions to wait, piano in her pocket, until phoned where to deliver it. We were by now collectively tearing our hair with frustration at the lack of a theater. And then a little man who had been with us for quite some time sighed and said, you'll have to take my house, I guess. It was the Venice Theater, now called the New Century, some 20 blocks away up on 58th Street and 7th Avenue. Jeannie was phoned and promptly brought an old upright piano to a sleepy caretaker who woke up on cue and managed to get four stalwart neighboring firemen to help lift the instrument onto the new stage. The theater's address was then announced to the audience outside the Maxine Elliott. And now commenced a parade up Broadway and 7th Avenue to 58th Street, with taxis containing Wells, Houseman, Abe Fader, our lighting man, myself, and reporters, all followed by an entire audience on foot, marching to see a show. By the time we reached the Venice, our original audience of less than 1,000 had doubled as the word spread. On stage at the Venice Theater, with the curtains closed, we pulled the front off the piano so that its guts showed, since in so large a house we needed a considerable volume of tone, and Fader arranged a spotlight for it. I could hear an enormous buzz of talk in the theater, and when the curtains opened and I looked, I saw the place was jammed to the rafters. The side aisles were lined with cameramen and reporters, and there was I, alone on a bare stage, perched before the naked piano in my shirt sleeves, it being a hot night. Myself, produced by John Houseman, directed by Orson Welles, lit by Abe Feder, and conducted by Lehman Engel, who had rushed home, got his winter overcoat, and returned to smuggle my orchestra score out of one theater and into another. There on stage, I couldn't know which or how many of our actors had elected to take Welles' suggestion, or where they were in the audience. But I started, ready to do the whole show myself. I began singing the Mall's first song of the play, and then I heard the words taken from my mouth by the Mall herself, seated in a right loge, and clever Feder promptly switched the spot to her. Well, she's here anyway, I thought thankfully. Then occurs a dialogue between the Mall and a character called the Gent. Again, I heard an actor take my melody and my lines from me, only this time from mid-center in the orchestra. Flashbulbs began to pop. The audience seethed with excitement. As the play progressed, they turned, as at a tennis match, from one actor to another, while Feder caught as many performers as he could with his spotlight, and musical conversations took place across the house. The cast had studied the work so thoroughly, they could have done it in their sleep, and this was much simpler. I did about 8 parts myself that night. Some of the actors had not wished to take their lives, or rather their living wage, into their hands. But at one point we all heard an accordion out front, joining my piano in the title song. The accordionist from my orchestra had dared to come and bring his instrument. Not a hitch occurred in the continuity, and some wonderful accidents of geography turned up. For example, Mrs. Mister was seen handing an imaginary donation from a balcony front box to the Reverend Salvation downstairs in mid-aisle. And the play itself held up astonishingly under this brutal and unpredictable manhandling. At the end of the first act, the poet Archibald MacLeish sprinted backstage to say a new day had dawned in the theater. The stagnant and supine audience had been killed forever, and he had to make a speech about it. And so he did, after the final curtain. And even that moment had its particular theatrical flair. MacLeish wore a Palm Beach suit, and when Welles held up his hand and finally stopped the roaring pandemonium that greeted us, saying, "We will all now sit down, and the one man left standing will be Mr. Archibald MacLeish," there stood that white suit, gleaming conspicuously, as we were told we had witnessed a historical event. Well, that's the story. Theater managers rushed to us within minutes and begged to be allowed to put us on Broadway in the exact form our show had happened that night. Later, Houseman and Welles put on The Cradle Will Rock as part of their Mercury Theater season. Critics were invited and gave us rave notices. Random House published the play with prefaces by Welles and MacLeish. Chapels printed the music score. There have been about 25 other productions of the piece in the United States and England. In 1947, Leonard Bernstein revived it in New York with his City Symphony, this time with the actors seated visibly in rows all through the performance, and this time with an orchestra, conducted by himself, playing my original orchestration at last. It was then moved to Broadway for the second time, where it had 2 successive producers. I have yet to enjoy The Cradle Will Rock in a regular performance with all its trimmings, but perhaps another 10 years will see that happen too, with sets and costumes and lights.